The story begins 5 years before Henry Tudor's birth, when a 9-year-old girl was summoned to court. Her name was Margaret Beaufort, and with her fortune of £1,000 a year, she was the richest heiress in England. Even more importantly, as the direct descendant of John of Gaunt, Duke of Lancaster, Margaret was of the blood royal. Her cousin, the Lancastrian King Henry VI, had decided that she should marry his own half-brother, Edmund Tudor, a man more than twice her age.
It was a sordid mixture of money and power, with the technicalities fixed by a venal and accommodating church.
Henry VI was weak. He'd failed in war, was incapacitated by long bouts of madness, and had fathered only a single child, thus leaving the succession dangerously in doubt. The union of Margaret and Edmund would, Henry hoped, strengthen the weakened royal family. It might even produce a future heir to the throne.
When Margaret was barely 12, the earliest legally permissible age for sexual intercourse, he brought her to Wales, where they lived together as man and wife. Shortly before Margaret's 13th birthday, she became pregnant. But 6 months later, weakened by imprisonment in a Welsh feud and finished off by the plague, Edmund died on the 1st of November. And his child bride, widowed and heavily pregnant, sought refuge with her brother-in-law here at Pembroke Castle. And it was in Pembroke Castle, in a tower chamber like this, that Margaret gave birth to the future Henry VII on the 28th of January, 1457. Actually, it was a miracle that both mother and child survived. It was the depths of winter. The plague still raged, whilst Margaret, short and slightly built, even as an adult, was not yet fully grown.
Probably the birth did severe damage to her immature body, because, despite two further marriages, Margaret was to have no more children. Yet, out of this traumatic birth, an extraordinary bond was forged between mother and son.
Behind every successful man, it is said, there is a strong woman. In Henry's case, it was his mother.
Margaret would need to be strong, because her son was born into an England torn apart by civil war. For their family, the Lancastrians, was not the only one with a claim to the throne. Their opponents were the three brothers of the House of York. They had at least as good a claim to the throne, which they determined to make good by force.
No one, a Yorkist chronicler exulted, of the stock of Lancaster remained among the living who could claim the throne.
But one Lancastrian claimant, however remote, did remain: Henry Tudor. 14 years had passed since Margaret had had her son. Now, the teenaged Henry was in danger of his life. Not even the massive walls of Pembroke Castle could protect the boy against the vengeful power of Edward of York, and his mother urged him to flee. He took ship at Tenby and crossed the channel to Brittany.
And there Henry was to endure a decade and a half of politically fraught exile before he would see either England or his mother again.
It was a plot between two powerful mothers, Queen Elizabeth Woodville, whose sons were lost, and Margaret Beaufort, whose son, Henry Tudor, was in exile, that would prove Richard's undoing and decide England's fate.
At some time in the late summer of 1483, Queen Elizabeth Woodville, still in sanctuary here in the Abbot's lodging at Westminster, received a visit from a singular Welshman, Dr. Lewis Caerleon. Dr. Caerleon was a scientific jack of all trades, mathematician, astronomer, astrologer, and physician, and he was a master of all of them. The sanctuary, of course, was heavily guarded by the king's men, but Dr. Caerleon was waved through because he was the queen's physician. He was also, not coincidentally, physician to Lady Margaret Beaufort as well. And, in his doctor's bag, he carried on Lady Margaret's behalf a remarkable proposal that the Queen's eldest daughter, also called Elizabeth, should marry Margaret's son, Henry, and that York, Woodville and Tudor should join together against the usurping Richard III. That Elizabeth accepted the proposal confirms that she was convinced that her sons were dead. That Margaret made it shows that she'd realised that Richard's murderous ambition had opened her son's path to the throne of England.
Margaret, now in her 40s, had been nursing her hopes for her exiled son, Henry Tudor, for years. Now she could put them into practice. His mother's plot underway, the 28-year-old Henry set sail from Brittany, where he'd lived in exile for 15 years to make his bid for England's throne. At Winchester in 1486, it seemed that the new Tudor dynasty had set the seal on its triumphant beginnings. The Queen had borne King Henry VII a son and heir. He was named Arthur, and his christening at Winchester Cathedral was designed to signal the start of a new Arthurian age. The baby's godmother was the Yorkist Dowager Queen, Elizabeth Woodville, whose kinsmen also played their part. King Henry had, it seemed, ushered in a new age of reconciliation, but it was to be short-lived. Just a few months after the christening, Elizabeth Woodville was stripped of her lands and sent to a nunnery, effectively banishing her from court forever.
What had happened? It was, almost certainly, because there were too many queen mothers and would-be queen mothers around. For Elizabeth Woodville, in her moment of restored glory, had reckoned without her sometime fellow conspirator, Lady Margaret Beaufort. Henry VII had already honoured Lady Margaret with the title of My Lady the King's Mother. But since she hadn't actually been crowned queen, she had to defer to Elizabeth Woodville, who had, and Lady Margaret didn't like that one little bit. So Elizabeth Woodville, Margaret decided, had to go. Indeed, Margaret gave precedence, only reluctantly, to Queen Elizabeth of York herself. She wore the same robes, signed herself Margaret R, and walked only half a pace behind the Queen. Lady Margaret, in short, was proving to be the mother-in-law from hell.
Margaret's behaviour was a political disaster. She was the heiress of the House of Lancaster. The humiliated Elizabeth was of the House of York, and the Yorkist nobility felt spurned too. Henry's dream of reconciliation was fading, and within a year he faced a major uprising by rebellious Yorkists, which he only narrowly beat off. Henry died on the 21st of April, 1509. He'd reigned for almost 24 years.
Henry was buried here, next to his beloved wife, in this magnificent lady chapel he commissioned at Westminster Abbey. A few feet away would soon lie the other significant woman in his life, but for whom he might never have been king, his mother.